Good morning, ma'am. I welcome you to the Clyde Talk Show. Clyde Talk Show is all about we try and understand the perception on safety and what are the challenges organization will face in future. This talk started almost a month back, and I appreciate your valuable time and you been coming on the show to discuss about process safety. I hope you and your family is doing well during the lockdown period, and I could see you are in the office, so you are still working.
Yeah. Yes, Mahendra. First of all, thank you for this opportunity to connect with the audience with my one of my favorite subject on process safety, which is so close to my heart. And in terms of lockdown, quite a lot of long time we were in green zone, and we did have that notion of being safe. Recently, there are little more cases. So, but then, yeah, I think we are doing well. And in terms of operations also in Goa, all the manufacturing sectors have been opened up for operations since April. So, we are operating and we are doing a good job, I should say.
Oh, that's wonderful. Nice to hear. But then, yes, a few days back, I also saw the news that the green zone has been converted into some other zone now. So, some of the challenges you'll be facing at this place. Having said that, let me just introduce you to the viewers who will be watching this video. Today we have with us Ms. Gitali Thakur. She has 18 years of experience. She is a gold medalist and a chemical engineer. She has worked with various organizations, and presently she is with Deccan Fine Chemicals at Goa as a EHS head. So having said that, ma'am, as you know, we were discussing about the topic, which is all about process safety. We thought about what are the challenges organization will face, because a lot of things are happening around, few accidents happening around during this period. So the today's topic is all about what are the challenges chemical industries face, and what should be the strategy for safe operation. So just like to understand from you the first question, what do you think are the future challenges in terms of process safety during the lockdown period and maybe after the lockdown period?
Yeah. So, Mahendra, as you rightly said, process safety, the impact of process safety is but much beyond the boundaries. And there are many incidents and accidents that have occurred in past, which have been quite grave in terms of its impact, not only in present, but in future, like what we talk about Bhopal. And that's how, in fact, it becomes very, very important to, especially for chemical industries, to have the highest standard possible for process safety in the organization. So process safety has its base to chemistry. And as the name suggests, it's basically a mystery. And the way that process safety professionals, we all professionals try to actually in fact, to work on this particular mystery is trying to get into some kind of risk assessments, looking at what kind of controls do we require, is this chemical going to be notorious, is this chemical going to be something which is like going to be a good student, a good candidate, and we do all these risk assessments. But what has happened now in the long period is our rigor always is much higher in terms of the routine operations and the plant shutdowns, and maybe some kind of earlier stoppage, but has never been to an extent where there has been a long abrupt shutdown. So it's abrupt as well as long, which has been a change with the existing situation. Now, in terms of the challenge that you say for talking about for lockdown resumption, there are two important challenges. And both have one thing in common, and that's turbulence. Turbulence in mind of people as well as turbulence in chemicals that are stranded there. So when it comes to people, I think, Mahendra, we for decades together, we have never been into such kind of uncertain situation, and we are at core of our instinct, where we want to really, we are striving to really remain safe and safer, which has not been so for decades together. And in that case, when many people are actually at home, we are calling to work and then, you know, starting the operations. So that turbulence of people, how people will think that, you know, that things are safer has to be leadership team, leaders across boundaries, across the organization have to ensure that this anxiety is taken care of. The second part of safety and a hero of process safety is the chemicals. I always say process safety is about letting the chemical remain in the pipe. So if we are able to do that, we are able to take care of health, safety, environment. When I say turbulence in chemicals, so let us treat chemicals as individuals which have got stranded now, and what are very similar to what has happened with people, and they are not very happy to be stranded, and they are stranded, and am I happy to be so? So we need to really ask, where is my notorious chemical and whether that is safe or not. So this particular tank, or this is the chemical in you, on whether do I need cooling? Do I need to be under nitrogen pressure padding? Do I need to be under nitrogen, basically the inert atmosphere? The chemical in these drums is asking you, am I stranded for too long enough to give up with off gases? And this can be not only related to the raw materials, but it can be also related to the waste streams. So what I mean is, many waste streams actually are unloaded into the drums, and then these drums are sent to some waste disposal facilities. So if many times, in fact, the data also around this is available. So if this is not taken care, it can lead to some kind of overpressurization, can lead to fire in the storages of these chemicals. So that's something which is not very safe. The other example that I want to give here, raw materials that could have been stranded on roads, that could be also on some ports, those also could be at your site. And again, the incident that occurred in the polymer industry, one of the reasons that was said is a particular inhibitor had to be added to keep this particular chemical safe, and quite possible that inhibitor had really degraded. So we know that peroxide handling requires to have inhibitors to keep this peroxide containing chemical safe. So this chemical is asking you, am I thermally decomposing? So do I need to do anything else to keep me safe? So what I would say is, if we have any of these kind of chemicals on route, ports, in our facility, we should liaison with all possible regulators and tell them that this is unsafe and I want to bring it at my site as soon as possible. The other example that I have is, I'm sure when we stopped, we all must have tried to take a safe shutdown and then gone ahead. So this particular slide is asking us, saying that as you did try to clean your vessels, you did try to clean the reactors, but I am remaining here in the pipelines. So after maybe 20 days or two, am I remaining here, and have I actually got plugged now? In fact, has it solidified there? So when you start the pump, is it going to be like a pump blockage? The discharge of the pump is blocked. And what do I need to do? So one message that I really want to give here, when I'm actually showing these two slides, is look at all possible places where your chemicals are stranded. They need your attention very badly, and they also want to be safe and keep us safe. So that is what I was talking about here, Mahendra, in terms of the challenges that we have when we resume operations.
Oh, so I understand an important thing from it, that chemicals are really, you can be friend with chemicals, but you have to take care of them. But if we ignore them now, it can be the situation can be a crisis management situation. Yeah. It can lead to an incident also. So chemical needs to be looked at as a friend, and then do a risk assessment properly. Involve your people, involve other regulatory authorities, and then try and keep your plant safe. That is exactly you're planning to say. So having understood that, shutdown was not planned because all of a sudden because of the crisis. So what do you think are the key drivers for the process safety? And plant should know, okay, these are the drivers, and if I work on these drivers, my plant will operate safely.
Yeah. So I would look at it as zero harm vision, and which we always talk about in safety and health and safety environment. We talk about zero, basically goal zero. Sure. That's always the goal, right? So I would look at it for process safety. The key drivers always have been top management commitment. The very, very important has been process safety data management. So it's not just the data, but how we have managed it in implementation. And based on these two, the key performance indicators that we have actually defined for our operations. So these key drivers will always remain so. Eternally will remain the same, whatever happens. Approach towards these key drivers is something which has changed and needs to be changed, needs to change in the given situation. Even before getting into process safety drivers, key drivers, I would say first thing that needs to be a focus of all the organizations is how about goal zero. So goal zero is again is an ambition. It's not something which is all organizations are always going to operate with allow as low as reasonably practicable. When we talk about the first thing that's required in a given situation is try to build as far as possible a COVID-proof workplace. And that's a key point. So really listen to employees and try to see how we can empower them to go to the minutest details and tell us where there are risks. And so the first thing is employee buy-in, because they are the ones who are operating the plant. The second thing, technically coming to the short term, considering that this situation is going to remain for some more months at least, operations have resumed, but with minimum manpower. And this minimum manpower actually means that we have got to operate. Some things have to be curtailed down. So what do we really need to do in terms of a short-term goal is say 30% of work manpower. So do a risk-based, take a risk-based approach and look at which are the things where I can actually, we have some management of safety critical equipments. We have basically inspection, testing and preventive maintenance. We have got some mechanical integrity, other related programs. So prioritized amongst all of this on, you know, which are the ones which has to be taken up immediately post the lockdown or shutdown, and otherwise could really lead to a higher issue. So the risk-based approach is something which is very important. The second thing that is important is, I would say, is taking care of contractual workforce. Because what's happening is there's a lot of hue and cry about migrant workers and then really retaining these contractual workers. So like never before, retaining talent has actually got now focused to the contractual workers. And from that perspective, it is very, very important to pitch in HR workforce into this particular into this whole gamut, and that in our case has helped to a great extent, and we have done a fabulous job. In long term, I think a wiser person is the one who learns from situations and challenges. So in a long term, we will have to build such kind of situations in our on-site emergency plan as well as in our business continuity plan. Something that I have, just one slide that I'd like to share. is not just talking about the pandemic, but something more important. I just share the screen with you.
Yeah, please.
Right. So there will be on the screen, you can see an incident at Arkema, Texas plant, and as recent as September 2017. My whole purpose of showing this particular slide is to say that it's not about process safety professionals. It's not only going to be about such kind of epidemic and pandemic situations in future, but also related to a much bigger challenge that's coming up, and which we all have been actually working upon, is climate change impact. And we need to be really ready for the worst. We really need to be prepared for that. And this is a particular case where a hurricane had hit and there was power loss. And this particular company is into manufacturing of organic peroxides. And two trailers at a in a time frame of 2 to 4 days actually went on fire, because these are organic peroxides which were stored at that particular site, and they need to be always stored under cooling. So these organic peroxides, when it reached a particular certain temperature, these are self-decomposing and can self-ignite. So that's what in fact happened. And we have to be really very careful. We will always need to, these kind of situations in our on-site emergency management plan, as well as into the mitigative measures. So that's something which I would really say is very important in terms of long-term. I actually spoke about mitigative measure. As a risk assessor, a very core core risk assessor in day-to-day life too. I mean, you know, that has got so much ingrained into me. In terms of preventive measures, I would say what we also need to do is companies and organizations, what I mean by being self-reliant is one of the key driver we spoke about is the process safety data. So process safety data, from where do we get it? So we get it from some other carry out this process hazard lab studies, etc., because not everyone has their own process hazard lab. At least at the minimum, the differential calorimeter, can we really have it with ourselves? Can we in fact build our professionals to do those particular data? That's one. Then I had also got a query from one of the pharma company around, and person asking on, is there anybody whom you know who can carry out, say, the hazardous area classification? And we are not able to get anyone in Mumbai or from Mumbai or Pune or anywhere else to do the studies in Goa because of the existing situation. So I would say self-reliant in getting the basic foundation knowledge base at their own organizations, and I'm very sure that people in the existing group new things and implement it at site. So self-reliance is the other key that I would say is in long term for such, that we have learned from such kind of situation.
Oh, that's wonderful. So I always summarize, so I would understand one point which was very important is, empower people at this point, because if you empower them, they are the one who are going to run the plant, they are going to make the plant safe. Second, I learned about is the talent, retention of the talent. HR should be involved, it should be a collaborative approach with the safety and the HR department. Third key driver, which I understood, was the data is the king. In process safety, data is the king, and you should have data to do a lot of analysis so that you know where we stand and how decisions should be made based on the present data. And you talked about some short-term and some long-term strategies the organization should follow so that they should have be ready for the such kind of situation in the future. Such kind of situation will definitely arise. So on-site emergency plan should have such kind of situation in future. So you would say company should revise year onwards their on-site and off-site emergency plan so that such kind of situation or such kind of emergencies can be rehearsed. Or modules can be conducted around it so that they are ready for the next. If at all something happens, nothing should happen, but then if at all should happen, company should be ready for it. Having understood all those things, as a lot of accidents has always happened in the process industry during the shutdown period itself, if you see the data itself, as you talked about data, if you see the last present data of many years. Many accidents have happened during the shutdown and during the pre-startup of the process safety plant. So what are the initiatives you and your team has taken to avoid any kind of incident? And as you said, zero harm is the vision. So how to achieve this? What all new initiatives you and your team has taken in your plant?
Yeah. So the first thing has been team effectiveness. And as we spoke about, the key drivers for process safety is the top management commitment. So all the leaders and the kind of bonded approach that we had in the given situation was something really good. So what I mean here is we right from the beginning, we looked at how, I mean, we were very people-centric when we had to really start with the operations. And we looked at how we could keep our people safe. And we did the one thing that we did, a network of team leads, or you can say observers in each area. And we spoke to them, we told them on what are the controls that we would have, and then we in fact empowered them to come with minimo suggestions. And we actually went through the PDCA cycle. So we planned, looking at, you know, where are risk lies, we carried out those changes. Then we in fact we have an one happens at the section level, and one actually that happens with EHS. And so this plan, do, check and act cycle has been working very well and has really proved very effective. So we have gone to the minutest detail so that somebody comes up with some suggestion, and you know, that's taken time to implement, or that's not been implemented. So so people think that yes, I mean, you know, they are part of the system, and it's not just that EHS or say HR has given some governance and that has to some system and it's into governance. So it's never been that. So that's been one. The second thing is, as I spoke about, risk-based approach. So which are the real key things, because we had lesser manpower to start with. Which are the real key things to look at, and which are the higher priority risks that we need to really look at before we start. So risk-based approach was the second thing. And third thing, as an outcome of this situation, is frugality. So how can we really get more from less? And we otherwise end up asking for more manpower. We say that, you know, yes, this work is there, that work is there. But the COVID time, the small microbe actually has taught us that yes, in fact, you know, you can do priority levels. And in fact, you can do much more than what you think is the capability. So we have been as a very bonded team, and have come up with this kind of approaches.
That's wonderful. You've been talking about one important aspect every time. There has to be a risk-based approach, and risk-based thinking has to be developed in the people who are working, and with less manpower, as I said, 30% of the capacity is running. So you can't ask more at this point of time, because you won't get also. Resources are really... We will save the resource now, because being this pandemic situation. So having understood on many aspects on process safety, the strategy, one thing I would like to know, or I want you to, any kind of thoughts you want to give to the team who will be watching this as a safety professional, what they should do now at this point of time?
Yeah, I would say, some things from my experience, four things. The first thing I would say is, as EHS professional, we are like parents, or we are like a mother, we are like a parent to whom other people look at. So the first thing is, what you are trying to actually teach other people, really imbibe those values in yourself. And when I mean imbibe those values, it's not just at workplace, but even in your lifestyle. So that's something, walk the talk is something which is very important as a leader. The second thing is about going beyond boundaries. So don't really think that I'm a safety professional, or I'm a safety officer, I'm a safety manager, really go beyond and part of solution. I've also, in fact, many times observed that when we as safety professionals, just as a safety professional, let us take an example, wouldn't really try to go and learn about environment legislation, or wouldn't really try to go and understand about more things about, say, occupational health. So at least first, let us widen that horizon, then go beyond and try to understand how, say, a certain production thing works, how a particular equipment works. Because once you're part of the team, people accept you more than as a person who is handling the governance of the systems, etc. So be a, so I would just say go beyond boundaries is the second thing. The third thing that I would really say is third thing that I would really like to actually talk about around here is try to build your skills. And try to build your skills every 4 years. You should really try to actually build in a new skill into your CV, I would say, which is and try to actually use that particular skill. So that has been a that helps people to get groomed in their career. The other thing that I would say is more importantly for ESS people is dirty your sleeves. So now it's not just about having the systems written down on paper, but try to go and see how those are really working, and are people actually really comfortable in implementing those, the kind of personal protective equipment that I'm asking people to wear, are they comfortably able to wear it? So the kind of feel that you would get of a shop floor by being in the shop floor and feel of people who are working with that. You know, trainings or no classroom talks could actually ever teach us that. And that's really very important when we are at our initial part of career, because that's irreplaceable with anything else. And the last thing that I would say is, as EHS professional, we are into a noble profession, and we are a resource to our nation. So that's my request to all EHS professionals, to be a resource to the nation. So what I mean is, when you are even beyond your organization, wherever that you are, try to see on what are, is there someone who is, let us say, on the road, which is without wearing a helmet, can you really, in fact, give him your thought? Is there anyone who is, and then me and my children, we do it. I mean, we really actually do it on roads. So really try to see what, how we can have a better place with our knowledge that we have otherwise also.
To summarize it, I would say readers are always leaders. So you want to say, enhance your skill, keep upgrading yourself. So keep reading something or the other in the life, so that tomorrow, if you want to be the leader in this field, no, reading is most important. That is what I could make out from that, whatever you said about skill enhancement and adding new skill set to your profile. So, first of all, thank you so much, ma'am, again, for your valuable time you have spared for this wonderful session on process safety. Before I could leave, this was coming to my mind when I was talking to you, to know, being a woman in this field, do you really think it is an edge or it is a barrier? I have seen for the first time, I've come across a woman as a head, a safety head. So what do you think? It's a barrier or it's an edge to you?
Mahendra, good question. In reality, I have never come across anything called as glass ceiling. So organizations look at an individual or the candidate as someone who can deliver results, who can deliver what's required by the role. And I've always been very fortunate to have good line managers. So it's, so I've never had those kind of barriers. I think you may call it as an edge that I had always, like probably for a men on a shop floor, maybe if you go and really try to tell the other colleagues that, you know, do a certain thing in a certain particular time, which doesn't really maybe happen with me or maybe any other woman in this field. And that's in the other way around, we do get a we do get an ear to hear. And so it has always been an edge. A small anecdote, in fact, what what had actually happened. So in 2005, I had attended one manufacturing excellence program, and there were many who were there at that talk. So those days, maybe 15 years ago, having women in chemical industry was not that often. And the speaker said, gentlemen, because there are all gentlemen around here. And I was the only lady, and people started looking at me around, the ones who were sitting next to me. And during the tea break, the speaker came to me looking at my long plait and said, oh ma'am, I'm very sorry, I didn't notice. And I was in a white shirt and black towel trousers, because I thought that was superior to be amongst men. So things have changed since then. Things have changed to a great extent. You see many more ladies, women actually on shop floor and in this, and in the chemical industry. I've personally seen that change. And that's a change for good. What happens with us is, in fact, we are not only into the inspector's job, but obviously when we go onto the shop floor, we'll see somebody who is with glasses. Wo sab kuch to apne aap hi aa hi jata hai, saying that, you know, please do that. But also what happens is, if I'm into a particular area, I would also see whether they have got enough of drinking water in that area, whether they have enough of wash facilities. I would ensure that those things are done. Now with the heat wave, I was even gone to an extent to look at whether we really require ORS to be kept in those areas. So I think if you employ a lady safety officer, you also have a welfare officer along with it. So that comes spontaneously. I would like to just give one example of how women in this particular field go beyond with their thoughts. And that's not just into operations of EHS. I'll just give you one example. I'll just share my screen with you, Mahendra. This is at my site. You can see this lady who is actually cleaning or sweeping this road. We have a big site and all the dry leaves have to be... So that's her job. Her 8 hours job actually is to clean the roads and garden the basically water the plants. And when we were looking at ergonomic risk assessment, and when we were looking at the manual handling capability of in the operations area, somebody really trying to push the pallet trolley, etc. I looked at, why are we not talking about ergonomics of people on the in the gardening area? So that was something which we said is also, in fact, such a big risk in terms of in the non-operational area. So as a area, tick mark and said that my ergonomic risk assessment is completed. But this was so evident when I used to walk down on the roads that we took this up a very small initiative, and we were able to actually bring in a lot of difference to their lives on a day-to-day basis. We express this gratitude towards this particular small initiative that we had. So that's the change that I think I would encourage a lot of women to actually join EHS, as well as a lot of organizations to actually have more women in EHS. That's going to really make a lot of difference.
Oh, that's really wonderful. Really wonderful. And even said, with a woman, the care measure automatically comes, and with men, inspector job automatically comes. So I need to get out that inspector job now. But thank you so much, ma'am, for joining the show and sharing your wonderful thoughts. We really appreciate whatever thoughts you have shared. And thank you so much. We'll meet soon again. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, Mahendra.